Let's make the show a little bit better as well and bring in Jonathan Tavernari, who joins us on the Deseret First Credit Union Hotline. JT for three, ready to throw some high heat.
He's got the 3YU shirt on, too.
Yes, he does. Of course. Nice. Like, it's a perfect match, right? JT, I love your shirt.
Hair's looking good.
Yeah.
It's growing back.
Okay. How'd you get a haircut in the quarantine, man?
I married above my means, and so, you know, my wife is also my personal
stylist,
my personal barber.
Wow. Yeah. Okay. Hey, we can use some more optimism right now amidst 2 months of no sports. How have you maximized this time?
I enjoy it. You know, I'm around my family more, and you know, I get to be around my loved ones. You know, and to be honest, that this is something that when we were in Europe, we had a lot of downtime, right? But it's not like we could, you know, go tour a whole lot of places, because we would have 1 or 2 days off and have practice and things and so forth, and have to get in and take care of shooting or some treatment or whatever. So, you know, having downtime and, you know, only going to the backyard or going to a park and shoot some hoops with my son, or, the eventual go to a drive through or a takeout. So it's, you know, I think the best part has been spending time with family. So.
Yeah, that's been nice for sure. Let's talk about BYU hoops. So we've been discussing national analysts. Some are in, some are out on BYU in terms of just preseason kind of tourney team, right? Dickie V over the weekend saying, look out for BYU. What's your opinion of where BYU will be perceived going into the season, assuming we start on time? Will they be a team that's perceived as a tourney team right away, or will they have to fight their way in?
Well, first of all, thanks for having me on Cinco de Mayo. Nothing like having the Brazilian guy, Latino guy on that, you know. So I appreciate that, right? You know, thank goodness for affirmative action, and that was born in there. I really appreciate it, guys. And I'll get to the answer in a minute. But, Jerem, outside of eventual tan that you got when you were in Brazil, what other Mexican heritage do you have?
My mom grew up in Mexico, bro. Okay, my grandparents and my great-grandparents grew up in Mexico.
Got it. Okay.
So that's legit. Anyway, JT.
Right? Yep. So, hey, thanks for clearing that up, guy. I've saw Spence, my bad. But,
okay.
You know, I think that here's the thing. And I got a little bit of heat by this on social media. But in my personal opinion, the fact that BYU is getting talked about, it goes beyond – Matt Harms' quality as a basketball player. And this is no way in shape or form related to how good of a shot blocker it is or a presence or this and that. But I think the fact that people are kind of just forgetting about it a minute is Mark Pope went toe-to-toe with Blue Chips program. I mean, he went toe-to-toe with Blue Breeds and just high-quality programs, and he beat them for somebody that he really wanted. And I think that in itself, it's one of the main reasons why BYU is getting so much hype. Now, you know, with the core that they have with Alex and with Connor, you know, now that, you know, Gavin came back and got his toes wet a little bit, I think Kobe is going to be a major factor. I mean, we saw Kobe improve tremendously during the season, right? I mean, let alone what all of this period that he can get in a gym and work out and so forth, what's going to do to that kid? Richard and somebody else that I think is going to have a huge impact. And the same thing with Wyatt, along with Travenel, somebody that we barely got to see it, along with some other guys that, like Wade got hurt, you know, towards the beginning of the season and couldn't play. So I think that along with, you know, coming this prized selection that, you know, again, Matt Harms, a 7 foot, you know, 7 footer of that magnitude. When was the last time the BYU got one of those? It's been for quite some time, right? And, you know, by no way, shape, or form, I think that just adding him to the mix is what puts BYU at that top echelon to be able to be considered a powerhouse or a national impact. But I do think that, wait a minute, this guy chose to go to BYU instead of Kentucky. You know, that raised some eyebrows. And so will they get some national rankings right off the gate? Possibly. You know, I don't see why not. Alex had a tremendous season. So did Connor. And here's the thing. Connor did all of that on probably a knee and a half, right? Because he had his brace and he wasn't 100%. And so, and let me tell you something. And you guys know how I feel about, you know, being the 3-point shooter. Travenel can shoot the rock. I mean, he's got a pure stroke and he's got a good rhythm. I think he's going to be really good next year. And again, to have Dickie V say that, you know, watch out Gonzaga. I mean, you know, he does know what he's talking about.
But what do you think he means by that? Because I don't see BYU winning the league over Gonzaga, but perhaps in Vegas, is that what we're referring to?
Again, you know, if you really think about that, BYU was maybe one or two games away from being able to challenge Gonzaga for the WCC regular season. I don't see why not, right? You see the game, you know, there was a game that they dropped. I think it was San Francisco, that it was just a tough game. You get situations like that. You never know, right? And I see, and obviously Gonzaga is going to be the number one team, you know, probably in the country. But you never know with these bad breaks. And again, having that nucleus, that core group. I mean, you're talking about Alex, you're talking about Connor, you're talking about Kobe, you're talking about Gavin, you're talking about Trev, you're talking about all of these guys. You can have about five or six players that were around Mark Pope last year and his staff that kind of know what to expect, set the tone. I mean, Alex is going to be definitely, you know, a ferocious leader where up in the morning workouts, hey, do the right thing, do that. And so I don't see why not. Again, you know, you guys kind of put me on the ice box for a week when I said that BYU was going to go undefeated, you know. And then, you know, I guess my, you know, my Latin friend over here that I just found out today, he tells, you know, he's like, well, I'm all in, you know, things evolve and, you know, things get better. And so I don't see why, you know, BYU can shoot to maybe just have, you know, just one or two losses for the regular season and get into conference with that rhythm, because, and again, I know I'm going a little bit too long, but you guys remember that last year, as soon as they got in the rhythm, I mean, that game against Gonzaga at home was unbelievable. And so, I don't see why, you know, these things couldn't happen.
Jonathan Tavernari with us on BYU Sports Nation. Clearly, the dynamic of this team is going to be so starkly different because out go the three-point shooters of Toulson and Hawes and even Yoli Childs, who was shooting almost 50% from beyond the arc. And in comes this insurgence of size. Jeremy and I both feel that BYU needs another ball handler and a scoring guard for BYU to really be in the conversation of, hey, they're going to finish top two in the WCC, and they are a tournament team. Do you feel differently? Do you feel like BYU has enough tools in the shed right now to get it done and not have to bring in an additional guard?
Well, and that's one of the things that they're looking right now, the transfer portal, right? It's one of the things that we're going to talk about here in a few minutes. But, you know, it's an interesting thing because if you look at how do you play a seven-footer, right? I mean, you know, this guy, by all means, he's not so much a back to the basket type of guy, right? So much like Kobe that you can get a bucket. And so you're going to have to figure out a way that you can play in and out. And because again, a 7-3, that is something that you need to take advantage of. I mean, how many guys have we seen coming through Gonzaga that are 7-3 and that BYU can finally match with them, right? I mean, I can think of one of my boys, Zach Collins, you know, from Gorman. And so, but I think that this is something that BYU can take advantage of. The whole reason why I, you know, on the record books, I'm one of the best ever shoot at BYU is because of Trent Plaisted, is because of Chris Miles, is because of Brendan Davies, is because of Noah Hartsock, is because of Lee Kamard, Tyler Haas, all of these guys that they played on the post. So they would play in and out, I would space out because a lot of times when I played a pick and roll, people would switch on me. And so I think that this is something that with Trevin, with Alex, with Connor, okay, maybe they got another guy there that can maybe not only be a ball handler, but be a space the floor type of guy like Dalton Nixon Flores last year. Dalton Nixon, in the beginning of the season, was knocking down threes like, you know, it was just, you know, almost like a revival of playing in and out, sharing the ball. And so I think that not so much another ball handler as much as it would be the key for how Mark Pope and the boys can develop Matt Harms playing back to the basket so they can play in and out and create mismatches on the perimeter.
Okay, so at this point, you're on the tournament train. Have you purchased your ticket?
You know, I don't see why not, and I don't think it's so much as a tournament train as much as, you know, when has BYU consistently been a good? When they have continuation, when they have, you know, underclassmen and then upperclassmen that they can kind of progress. And BYU hasn't had that for a while, you know? And so with everything that happened last year, and again, Yoli being now is a travesty, but, you know, we're not going to talk about the NCAA and all of that. And but if you think about the sequence, the continuation that there is now with Alex Barcelo and Connor Harding is going to be a junior and Gavin's going to be a junior. And so you have that continuation of freshmen coming in, and then you have sophomores and juniors, and then you have your senior leadership. Again, obviously you're not going to have one of the best to ever do it in the program in TJ Hawes and Yoli Childs. You're not going to have, you know, a bona fide winner with Jake Toulson, but you do have a little bit of continuation. And so I think that guys know what it takes to get there. And again, you know, BYU is not Kentucky, is not Duke. We're not the lands of one and done. And I think that when Coach Rose really got consistent was when Keeney Young was a senior, I was a freshman. And then I became a sophomore with Lee Kamard. And then Charles Abua came in and I was a junior. And that continued. And Jimmer was a sophomore. They became a senior with younger guys like Kyle Collinsworth and Tyler Hawes. And so that's when BYU flourishes, when you have that continuation and so forth.
JT, thank you for being the resident Brazilian to help us celebrate Cinco de Mayo, man. Great to catch up with you.
I really appreciate it. Jerem, just so you know, Brazil is not Mexico. You don't speak Spanish down there.
I am well aware.
Muchas gracias por tu atención, mi gran hermano latino. Fuerza México! You good now, Jerem? You know what that means? So, I know you said that you're kind of Mexican now, so I, you know. Yo tengo que inserir esas palabras ali, muchacho.
Yep.
He has no idea what I said.
Oh, the man of many languages. JT, great stuff, man. We'll talk to you soon.
Appreciate it, guys. Have a good one.
Jonathan Tavernari on the Deseret First Credit Union Hotline. Deseret First, you know why, we show how.